I'm Ryan Dombrowski.
I'm the Ninja Fat Man from Doom Ninja Podcast,
a podcast member of the Gunna Geek Network.
Just like the show you're listening to now.
The opinions expressed are those of each individual host.
Check out all the other podcasts at GunnaGeekNetwork.com.
And get ready, because geekiness begins in
3, 2, 1.
You have been granted clearance by Director Jeffrey Mace. Stand by for S.H.I.E.L.D. debriefing. All information to be discussed here is classified and may only be discussed among agents granted clearance by the S.H.I.E.L.D. director.
Now it's time for your scheduled debriefing. I'm Director Stargate Pioneer.
I'm Agent Lauren.
And I'm Consultant Michelle.
Welcome to Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D., a Marvel Comic Universe fan show. This is show number 155, discussing Luke Cage, episode 3, Who's Gonna Take the Weight? And Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Slingshot Webisodes. This show is recorded on Wednesday, December 21st, 2016. Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. is a fan-based podcast on the ABC television show Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Marvel's Daredevil, Jessica Jones, and Luke Cage on Netflix, the Marvel Cinematic Universe, and the Marvel Comic Universe in general.
Because of shady morticians.
If you'd like to talk to us about shady morticians, you can find us at our website, legendsofshield.com.
You can find us, you can send us a voicemail at 844-THE-BUS-1. That's 844-843-2871.
You can find us on Facebook at Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. Podcast.
You can get a hold of us on Twitter at Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D.
You can see our videos on our YouTube channel, found on the Gunna Geek YouTube channel, youtube.com/GunnaGeek.
Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. is a proud member of the Gunna Geek Network.
This time on Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D., we're going to be talking about our current giveaway. We're going to be talking about Slingshot, Luke Cage, the weekly Marvel news, your feedback, and highlights from the live chat room at geeks.live. First and foremost, we're going to be talking about our giveaway. We have this great convention, MegaCon convention, provided art by our listener and co-host on Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. Longbox Edition, Black Adam. It is an 11 by 17 fan art of Agent, then Agent when it was made. Now director, now ex-director, and now back to Agent Coulson. It is a great thing to see. I just showed it on the YouTube, so if you are looking for what it is, it's made by Jamie Foxx, as it was linked.
Jamie Faye,
that's right, not Jamie Foxx. Jeez, SP, what are you thinking? And it was made by...
Yeah. If you want to look it up, it's J-A-M-I-E. F-A-Y.
I was just going to
say, a sample of what you're going to be getting.
I was just going to say, it was linked in the show notes for last week. Now, what you have to do to get this is just tell us what's your favorite Coulson moment. I don't care if it's in the comics. I don't care if it's in the movies. I don't care if it's in the show. I don't care if it's in your made up fan. Well, I do, because it's just got to be available for everybody. So something that everybody can see from Agent Coulson, and then get it to us in some sort of form, which we can go back to and reference later. So it can't be in the chat, but it can be on our Twitter account. It can be via Facebook message, or you can email StargatePioneer@GunnaGeek.com. Lauren, we got 2 entries this week.
Yeah. So our 2 entries so far, the first one is from our friend Johnny at Born to Eat Bacon on Twitter. Picking a favorite Agent Coulson moment is like picking a favorite Far Side cartoon. I got to agree, it's pretty hard. They're all pretty good.
Yeah, I miss Far Side. I don't read much Far Side anymore.
I used to have those tearaway, you know, comic a day calendars.
Right.
And it was always Far Side. Yeah, and I still have a bunch of the books. And our second one is from at Anthony Bachman. Favorite Coulson moment is from Avengers. So that's what that does. When Coulson, a well-armed human, takes out Loki, a god.
Way to go, Coulson.
That was pretty badass.
Yeah, way to go, Coulson. Now, Michelle, You've been thinking about this for all of, 10 minutes maybe. So my question to you is, do you have a favorite Coulson moment that you want to let us on to right now, or do you want to wait before you enter the contest?
Actually, I'll share. Mine is when his new high-tech hand made the shield. I thought that was kind of awesome.
Awesome. Well,
that's pretty great.
The shield, anything to do with his high-tech hand is pretty good, if you ask me. You know?
Yeah. Anytime Coulson's around to give you a hand.
That's right. So that's what you got to do. You've seen the poster if you're on YouTube. You have heard us talk about what you need to do. So just get it to us by January 25th, 2017. We're going to talk some Slingshot now. Slingshot came out just a few weeks ago. We have not had a chance to talk about it on the podcast. Matter of fact, it came out like the day before we podcasted last week. It is 6 short webisodes that Marvel put out on their YouTube account. And by short, I mean anywhere.
Like 5 minutes.
Yeah, 3 minutes, 45 seconds to 6 minutes. That's it. So it's about half an hour if you watch front to back. And it's even faster if you watch at 1.5 or 2.0. But you don't want to do
slingshot
that.
Slingshot like 20.
That's right. If you could get it. Yeah. So there was a host of directors and writers for this. It wasn't just done by one person. So let's march down the directors for all 6 episodes. Lauren, who do we got out with the first episode titled Vendetta?
First is Joe Quesada, who has worked at Marvel for a long time. He's written, he's drawn, he's edited, and lately he's just been kind of behind the scenes guy.
The second director was Felix Parnell, and he did John Hancock. Michelle, who did the third episode?
That's Chris Cherami. Did Reunion.
Yeah.
Then we had Keith Potter, who did Progress.
John P. Gordon did the penultimate webisode with Deal Breaker.
And Mark Kolpak did Justicia.
Is that how you're supposed to say that? Justicia?
Justicia. The J in Spanish is an H. Justicia.
I was like, is it Justicia? I don't know. How do you say that? You say, I'm not a Hispanic person. I don't speak Spanish, so I just can't do that. But thanks for letting me know. Justicia.
Justicia.
All right. So we looked into the IMDb for this. We saw 6 writers, and I was like, oh, cool. 6 writers, 6 directors. There must have been a writer for each webisode. Am I right, Lauren?
You are not correct.
Oh! What happened?
Well, there are 6 writers credited, but the first 2 writers who were credited for all 6 episodes are Jack Kirby and Stan Lee. There's only 2 problems with this. Stan Lee, we're pretty sure, has not written anything in years. He's done a couple of comics things, but because he has vision problems, he doesn't really do much with comics these days, other than the cameos and speaking at conventions and things. And Jack Kirby's been dead since 1994.
Oh, well, maybe he wrote it knowing that YouTube would exist in 15 years.
Or maybe he time traveled or did it through the portal or something.
Oh, yeah, it could have been. I mean, NBC's got that Timeless show right now, or, you know, plenty of time traveling stuff with the mutants in Marvel, right?
Some of which he has written in the past, yes. Well,
So, Lauren, who do we have as actual accredited writers for this series?
Actual accredited writers. For the episodes Vendetta and John Hancock, we have James and Sharla Oliver.
Oh, did you know, are they married? Are they brother,
sister?
I have no
idea.
Oh, okay, who knows? And then for Reunion, Aiden Bogdakci was the accredited writer for Reunion.
Yeah.
And Michelle, who actually did Progress?
George Kitson.
All right. So the Olivers, Iden, and Kitson were the four writers for four episodes. And then for the other two webisodes, the only accredited writers are Stanley and Jack Kirby, neither of which do we really expect to have wrote this. So we're going to have to look into exactly who wrote the final two episodes, which would be Hussecia and Dealbreaker. So with the real writers for those webisodes, please step forward. All right, Michelle, what did you think about this webisode series?
I thought it was interesting. I love, you know, seeing Yo-Yo anytime. She's quickly become one of my favorites. I guess it's good that I wanted more, but then it's not good because I wanted more. I mean, it was kind of good to see, like, because it takes place, like, right at the beginning of the season, like right before Coulson and Mac are on the plane and all that type of stuff. And, you know, Daisy's all being emo Quake. So it was interesting to see a little bit of that.
Lauren, what was your take on all of them?
I thought they were fun. I love Yo-Yo. It's seeing her on TV and seeing her starring in her own thing, even if it's a web series, is huge for me because, I mean, growing up, there were like no really positive Hispanic female role models. If you're on TV and you're a Hispanic woman, you were either a maid, a grandma, a hooker, or a criminal. And nowadays, you know, that kind of changed with Selena. But nowadays, I mean, we're superheroes. So it's kind of great. And then she's a lot of fun to boot. And you see her using her powers in clever ways. And you see her, you know, getting kind of her backstory gets a little bit more complex. And just interacting with the cast again. And it's a nice little kind of teaser and like a snack in between the break.
It was a nice little thing, and it went back to fill some holes in the storyline from between the last season and this season of what happened specifically between Daisy and Yo-Yo. So I think that we haven't heard the rest of this. I think maybe this was just their way of tidying it up so that Daisy deleted her position for that particular night, but I still think it's not gone. It will see it again as we go forward to the end. The one problem with that, though, is that this happened in a webisode, and if you take a look at the amount of views on each webisode, you're talking like 55,000 per webisode. So it's not the entire fan base of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. that have flocked YouTube to see this. So I think it might be taken out of context if it is brought up again in the series.
That's an interesting thought. You know, how, was it sort of just like, as Lauren said, a snack and something that, you know, we got and then it's just put away? Or are they even going to do something else with it?
I would love to see more in this vein, whether it's with the storyline or with other characters, just throughout the year. Like, I would like it if Marvel kind of realized, hey, maybe this is a nice, cost-effective little thing to do with the fans. Kind of like the Marvel shorts, but a little meatier. I've said before, I am very vocally for more along the lines of the Marvel shorts. And if we can do something like that, where we get something that has a bit more of a plot and more opportunities for these characters and these actors who seem to have fun playing the characters to just come in and do a thing for like a week.
This had to have been...
I mean, who isn't for that?
Right. This had to have been fun to shoot, because really you're talking about one scene at a time. It's like a mini play, you know, you're getting the front and the back, and then it leads into the next one, because each one of the five had a short ending that led into the next webisode. It starts off in present day, and this is after the mid-season finale of the season 4 of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. So Daisy is boxing, And Yo-Yo comes in and says, okay, now that we're all here, you and I, we need to get our story straight because something's going on. And we're like, what happened? So then they cut away. They did the Wayne's World. No, they didn't do that. But that would have been cool if that happened. And then we got the next scene with the typed on screen several months ago. And did you catch all the Easter eggs as Coulson was coming down the stairs?
I didn't. I was paying too much attention to his axe.
Yeah, right.
Which sounds like innuendo, but no, he was carrying that axe out of presumably his office when he was demoted from no longer director.
Yeah, he was carrying out the red axe that had chopped off his hand that Mac used to chop off his hand to save him.
Good luck. Yeah. Good luck.
Yeah, I guess. So he was doing that. And then he had his box of stuff from the office as well. And in that box, I'll just give you a hint of one of the Easter eggs. You need to go back and watch it. One of the Easter eggs was a Stanley bobblehead.
That's cool.
Exactly.
I love this show.
Exactly. So Peggy Carter had a pin commemorating the start of S.H.I.E.L.D., which unfortunately we never got to in the Peggy Carter TV show that ABC canceled. But they keep on bringing references to that. And one of the references was the little pin that was Peggy's, and Coulson ended up with it. I don't know how, but he had it. And then he gave it to Yo-Yo for safekeeping because he was leaving on the bus and he wanted to make sure it stayed safe. And this is important because it comes back in the webisodes, but I don't think it was of major importance, but it was a nice callback to Peggy Carter.
This Peggy Carter, Agent Carter, is another thing that I think would benefit from, you know, this sort of half hour thing. We fans have made it very clear we don't want to give up Peggy Carter. So if we could just get another one of these, you know, little 6-episode, 5-minute each things, I feel like we might not be completely satisfied, but it would be so nice. And I know that like all of the cast has said, yeah, we'd love to do something like that. But back to the story. Yeah, I feel like that was more of a nod to the fans than anything else, but it was still very, very cool.
Now, to complete that thought, though, Michelle, have you ever watched an episode of Conviction?
No, and not a lot of other people did. In fact, I think its ratings are worse than Peggy Carter. So because we want to see Hayley Atwell as Peggy Carter, and it was like, it was great getting the mention, but it's like, great. Thanks with, you know, jabbing the stick a little bit more. It's, you know, Peggy Carter, you know, to me in like the Marvel verse is like Constantine and the DC TV thing. It's just like gone too soon. Bring them back. Oh, the pain.
It was low rated, but it was getting fun. And I don't think you needed to have any of the backstory in the Marvel Universe because that is the Marvel backstory. And it would have been fun if it continued. But my point was Conviction, and I don't wish this on anybody. I especially don't wish it on Hayley Atwell. Unfortunately, her show was canceled. So the positive note for Marvel fans is now she would possibly be available to do a series of webisodes. I don't know about the rest of the cast, but Hayley Atwell right now, unfortunately, is a free agent.
Yay.
Yeah, I know. It's like you can't win because she didn't win. Her series was not really... it wasn't a success, and it was against the NBC show Timeless. Timeless didn't rock the ratings either. And as we've discovered this fall with Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., nobody was rocking the ratings except for CW, who isn't rocking the ratings to begin with, by the way. They're hovering somewhere between 2 and 5 million viewers on a show in their comic book universe, right? Arrow's a little bit less than 2 right now, and on a good week, you can get Legends of Tomorrow and Flash up, but maybe close to 5, but definitely in the 3s. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. was in the 2s, and that's on a network show, and that didn't do well, and Conviction did even worse. So ratings across the board, I'm just using those shows as an example, but we've talked about
different news points in the past, like ESPN ratings being down, NFL ratings being down. It's not just these shows. So I don't know what if we're talking about a new norm. I don't know if it was the aberration of the 2016 United States presidential election, which was the issue. In any event, Conviction was canceled and Haley Atwell is available. And it, like I said, unfortunate. And as Michelle said, yay. But moving on into the rest of the webisodes, it was great how each individual webisode had a character or characters from the main show. And I know the second episode, Lauren, might have been your favorite webisode, and I'm just guessing.
Yeah, Fitz and Simmons showed up. I was honestly kind of surprised when Daisy showed up in the very first one, you know, punching back, oh, I'm back with S.H.I.E.L.D., whatever. I was thinking, because when I heard this announced, I was thinking, oh, it's just going to focus on one character. That way they only have to pay for, you know, this one character. And it's just kind of a little budget teaser to keep the fans happy. But then seeing that they brought in pretty much all of the main cast, you know, we got Coulson, we got Fitz, we got Simmons, we got Mace, we got Turtle Man, Mac, you know, in addition to, oh, we got May, in addition to Yo-Yo's storyline, it was way more than I was expecting. And yes, seeing Fitz and Simmons, you know, a tidy lab is a happy lab, which, yes, is true, because much as I am an extremely disorganized person, messy labs is where bad things happen. And reagents get mislabeled and misplaced and viruses get lost in fridges and bad things happen. But seeing them was fun. And her whole, you should think of moving in together. And it took me a second to remember, oh yeah, this is before the season started.
Yeah, it's amazing that they were allowed to share a room within the S.H.I.E.L.D. headquarters.
I know, I like how they were arguing about a TV.
Like, you know, people do.
They named the TV Bridget? Is that what that was?
He did, yes.
I never named my TVs. Fitz, that's a little kind bit of off a the nice, wall.
Well, it was kind of a nice, like, I feel like, tip to how he's the one that insists on calling Ada a she. Because you already have, he's an engineer. He named all of the drones. He calls Ada a she. He's already humanizing technology and things like that. He named his TV. So it was easy for him to kind of accept Ada as a person. And this sort of is a little nod to that.
All right. Well, everybody likes Fitz and Simmons. I'm not knocking him down. I'm just kind of...
No, it is weird. I don't name my TV. I name, like, you know, my phone, my computer. I named my iPod when I had one. But
what was your iPod's name?
Whistler.
Michelle, have you ever named your TV?
No. No, I have not.
Yeah, I haven't either. So anyway, the two of them, it was great seeing them in the lab and going on that apartment path. And I don't know why Fitz didn't want an apartment, because he did want an apartment later. So I'm not quite sure what that was. Maybe just the scary thing of moving in with a girl. Oh, no. Maybe. I don't know. Anyway, that one ends and then brings up another fan favorite. And I'd give this to Haley if she was here, but I'm going to give it to Michelle. Our next favorite character shows up in Agent May.
May! I was so happy to see May. Oh, my goodness. And I love the whole, you're a lousy spy. Like, I really enjoy how Yo-Yo isn't a good spy. Because sometimes there's a tendency to make superheroes good at everything immediately. Mm-hmm. And it's just good to see Yo-Yo make the mistakes of, you know, May's like, you know, you had access to Mace because we know who was already there. You were in the lab and, you know, somebody did this search. You know, you were just sloppy. Yeah. And then Mace just like, yeah, you're sloppy, but you know what? I'm going to help you out anyway, because I'm May and that's how I roll.
That's right. You're not going to LA. You's going to Baltimore. It actually took me to the second watch through to understand what happened. May sent her to where Ramon was. I mean, that wasn't a mistake. She did send her there versus LA on purpose.
Because May knows things.
May knows a thing or two about nailing your competition.
Oh, dear. Nail yeah. Hydra.
It was one of the best lines ever. I expected a joyous reaction to that versus the, oh, bad pun, SP. No, that was a good moment. Nail Hydra.
I know, but I had forgotten about it.
All right. So Yo-Yo gets busted. She goes to Baltimore. And while in Baltimore, she's supposed to be doing paperwork. She does not do paperwork. She decides to go after Ramon. And she finds him, but she also finds the watchdogs.
Yep. They're always there ruining everything.
And I'm wondering the masks. I'm wondering if, you know, like the shield gear in the first season was the thing for like a vendor to produce and make money. I wonder if they just switched all their shield production over to watchdog masks.
I mean, yeah, probably, because you lose your major business in evil companies because Hydra's gone. You gotta find a new, you know, you gotta fill the niche somehow. So when another evil organization comes along and is like, hey, we'll pay you to mass produce these masks, you say yes. Actually, you don't say yes. It's very bad, but
temps are tough.
They are all the way around. And we're talking about the superheroes coming into power and automatically being great at what they do. This is one of the cases I love. Daisy comes in to rescue Yo-Yo because Yo-Yo gets captured at the end of the one before when she goes after Ramon. And Daisy comes in and it's just the classic butt-kicking Daisy out there. She is an agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. without her superpower. She's very capable and it's just a wonder watching her or her stunt woman, one or the other, work. And we know that she has done her own stunts because she broke her wrist at the one-shot stunt at one point in time. And so we know it's her.
Yep.
But that just shows you Daisy's growth because, you know, that's one of the things I've liked about the show. You've seen her train with May and come into her own. And so that was good to see.
It was. You know, Michelle, what was also good to see for me, at least, was that Yo-Yo was not the one that was responsible for killing Ramon. Don't you think so?
Yeah, it was good that she was able to realize the difference between vengeance and justice and step back from that. But then the way Ramon goes, that was sweet.
Yeah.
So
killed with the own gun.
Right. So, Lauren, let's get into the science of the ray gun for a second. Yo-Yo can move faster than a ray gun?
If it was a plasma gun, maybe.
Because plasma.
Which I would say is probably what it would need to be. Because, you can't move faster than photons. That's, as far as we know, the speed of light is the fastest. But if it's like a plasma gun or something where it's matter that's being conducted, then yeah, it is possible for her to move faster than it.
Well, and it's all relative too. So if she's actually riding on one of the photons, she can move faster than it.
That's not how her power works though.
Fair enough.
She's still moving through matter. So yeah, I'm like, that has to be some sort of plasma energy sort of deal, that it's not just light. It couldn't be.
All right. Was this the gun from before in the series where Coulson's like, okay, that's what this does when he's going after Agent Garrett?
I didn't think so.
I swear we have seen that gun before.
I think we keep seeing that type of gun. You know, the blue plasmony type of weapon.
Well, I'm just going to throw this out. Haley or listener, because Haley will listen to this and go, you guys are stupid. It's this. And so if you're a listener and you said that same thing, please let us know. Send us a tweet. Give me an email, stargatepioneer@gunnageek.com, or call a voicemail line at 844-THE-BUS-1 or 844-843-2871 and tell SP how wrong he is on where that gun came from. In the meantime, they flip over after the rescue has occurred. Ramon is nowhere anymore, really, vaporized. And they go back to the present day. Daisy is back to her old hacking self. She hacks in and then deletes the watch's location so that they don't know that Yo-Yo, or Director Mace, doesn't know where Yo-Yo was that fated night. And to bring it full circle with Coulson and Agent Carter, Peggy Carter's pin, it is now in the hands of Sky.
I love how Daisy's like, wow, it's great to be back to S.H.I.E.L.D. Let me start hacking it again.
Well, it's Daisy.
Well, yeah, if she can't hack things, she's going to hack bad things. And
Which I still love that that's still such a big part of her character. I mean, despite her, you know, having superpowers and, you know, learning to fight and everything, it's like when in doubt, go back and mess with the computer.
That's right. So I really enjoyed watching these. They were fun to be able to sit down and watch. So we didn't have anything between the mid-season finale, and I believe it's January 10th when the season or the series comes back. So it was fun having that to entertain us. And Lauren, I can't speak for Michelle here, but because she doesn't come from the same background as we do, but webisodes are where we got our introduction to podcasting. With the podcasts that we listened to way back when. You don't remember that? The webisodes for Battlestar Galactica?
Oh my God.
Yeah.
I forgot all about those.
That's how you and I are both here right now.
Oh my God, it was so long ago.
Michelle, I know you're a Battlestar Galactica fan, but we listened to a Battlestar Galactica podcast and it began back in September 2006 as the webisodes were out there. God.
Wow.
Yeah. I forgot that's where it started.
That's right.
Oh my.
So we're not obsessing a full hour over what kind of red drink Fitz might have had on the table like that other podcast did with the Red Phantom. But we went through it rather quickly. But, it, you know, listener, if you want us to, we can break each of these webisodes down and talk about every 10 seconds. We can break it down that way. So if you want that,
you know me, I can talk. I can go deep and talk about, you know, symbolism and character motivation. And
that's right. And Lauren, Star Wars, go. No.
If you want to hear that, check out the latest All Things Good and Nerdy.
That's right.
I think I monopolized the conversation.
As long as you were there. Yeah, episode 241. And it was great conversation. Everybody actually had a chance to talk. It was good about Rogue One. And if you've seen that and want to be spoiled to listen to that, it will be on GunnaGeek.com. You guys ready to talk about some Luke Cage?
Always.
Right, we're racing towards the third episode in Luke Cage called Who's Gonna Take the Weight? Lauren, tell us all about the director, please.
Okay, so this has me really excited. The director was Guillermo Navarro, who is mostly a cinematographer with 43 credits going back to 1973. He's worked a lot with Robert Rodriguez. He also worked on Spawn, The Twilight Saga, Breaking Dawn Part 1 and 2, Pacific Rim. And he's directed 11 credits starting 2012, including Limitless, Preacher, and my favorite, 6 episodes of Hannibal. So
I was amazed when I started looking into who was behind the creativeness of this episode. And I started going down like Desperado, From Dusk Till Dawn. This guy knows how to do massive gun shooting scenes and action scenes, obviously, with Pacific Rim and Twilight Saga. He was the perfect guy to bring in for this hallway fight of a Marvel Netflix series. So I'm very grateful that they found the right guy for the job and they threw them in there. Now, Michelle, who was the writer for the episode?
The writer was Matt Owens, did one Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Let Me Stand By Your Fire, and one Luke Cage.
Yeah, so a relatively newcomer, although I think he did well. Michelle, what do you think about the writing for the episode?
I think it was really well paced. I like how it flowed from one, from the previous episode into this, and really sort of develop the fallout from Pop being killed and Luke sort of going from just being passive to starting to step up and take some action.
That's right. He stepped up not once, not twice, but many times. It was fun seeing Luke Cage out there breaking heads and cracking skulls or whatever they said back in the Breakfast Club. All right. The episode's title, we always start here after we talk about the creative team. Who's going to take the weight? Somebody please tell me where that line is from.
Well, again, it's from a Gangstar song. I'm going to start linking the lyrics in the show notes. And you can look at it as, you know, who's, I mean, you know, the words on their own, who's going to be responsible for whatever's going on.
That's a good thing, because there's a lot of responsibility that is going around in this particular episode, some of which is directly responsible, some of it is indirectly responsible, because whatever you do, there's a chain reaction of what you do. If you, for instance, you're driving to work, right, and you go through a red light and you hit somebody, there is a sequence of events that happens there that you might not be directly responsible for, but say the person that you hit can't go to their kids, whatever, that night, and the kid gets hurt in that as well. So there's a sequence of events that can occur in something, and this is definitely something that has happened. I really enjoyed this episode. It was fun. It was action-packed. It had surprises left, right, and backwards, including Misty's partner. I really enjoyed it. So far, to me, out of the three that I've seen, this is my favorite, and I'm only guessing it gets better from here.
Yes, you are correct there. It really does. Yeah, there's so much that gets dropped in this episode, whether it's Scarf being a crooked cop, which, again, if you go by, I'm not saying this is, you know, a blaxploitation sort of, there's a word I'm looking for, like template. But like we said last week, it's kind of got that feel. So you kind of expect there to be a crooked cop at some point in the story. The mortician being crooked kind of surprised me, but at the same time, not entirely, because of course, you know, somebody, you kill that many people, you have to have somebody on your side to kind of smooth things over for you. Yeah, we have Mariah. We see a lot more from Mariah's point of view. We get a little bit more of her backstory. And of course, Luke, we see him being more and more proactive. We saw him being a lot more willing to fade into the background in Jessica Jones and here. And now he's had his moment to go forward and do what he needs to do. And I think it's kind of interesting that, contrary to normal comic book fashion, I mean, yeah, his wife has died, but that's not the impetus to get him to be a hero. You know, there's that phenomenon, the woman in refrigerator trope, where a woman dies solely for the, you know, purpose of pushing a man to be a hero. Here we have Pop fulfilling that purpose. And it's kind of interesting that as opposed to his wife, is what gets him, like, his wife dying is kind of the thing that gets him to lay low. Pop's dying is the thing that gets him to rise up.
Yeah, interesting. I didn't think about that, that Pop was the impetus for him. Well, it wasn't just Pop. I mean, Pop inspired him, but if Pop hadn't died, I doubt he would have risen up. Michelle, what do you think about that?
Well, it wasn't, I think it's more than just Pop dying. It's more of like there's that void, and I think Luke is noticing that the void is going to be filled by a present that he doesn't approve of. Like, it gives Cottonmouth a way to sort of fill that void. And because another thing in this episode is like, you know, who's going to take the weight? It's also, it's not so much who like step up, but a lot of people are trying to like place the blame, you know, like Misty's starting to think it's Luke because he's in the middle of all of this. So she wants to blame him. You know, Luke is like, well, is it Chico? And Chico's like, no, it's Cottonmouth. But it's like, if they weren't so greedy, and it's, you know, it's like that, well, who is, you know, like SP, you said, like, you know, the person running the red light caused all this, but now it's, you know, another way can be like, well, you know, starting in one way and trying to find that moment that actually, you know, started all of this. And it's interesting about how everybody is trying to either fill the void or to keep it going. Cause really it's not so much Pop dying, because the guy says like, we need money to keep it going. And Luke's like, well, how are we going to get the money? And it, so Luke kind of acts out of not so much, you know, it's part justice for Pop, but also part wanting to keep that going. And he does it in kind of a shady way.
Yeah, a little bit. But also, if you have crooked cops and you see this going on, vigilantism, it almost, it seems like the right thing to do, really. And in the superhero universe, you're talking about vigilantes all the time. Mm-hmm. Luke Cage started this episode with the couch being thrown out of the window of quote-unquote Fort Knox. And I thought that the hallway scene was going to be the biggest action scene of the whole episode. I was wrong. And that was just shocking at the end, throwing a shoulder-launched missile into a building, having the building collapse. Of course, Luke Cage is going to survive, but there's other people in there. And that's just, for Cottonmouth to do that, it's a little above and beyond, but that's like poking the bear, right? Eventually, the bear is going to strike back, and that's exactly what happened. We'll see the aftermath in next episode, but oh my gosh, when I saw that come off the rails, oh, this is not good at all. And
that's another use of the whole who's going to take the weight thing, is Cottonmouth and Mariah. They're both trying to sort of take responsibility for keeping Harlem Harlem. And like we've talked about last episode, they're doing it in different ways. Mariah is sort of pawning off some of that responsibility on Cottonmouth by tacitly agreeing to, well, not really tacitly, even just saying like, okay, you do your thing as long as it doesn't come back on me. It's like, she's fine with all these criminal activities going on so long as it helps her cause. And Cottonmouth is, taking all this responsibility by trying to consolidate his criminal empire, whether it's through, you know, attacking Luke Cage to take out a perceived threat, or going up against Domingo Colon to sort of, you know, do a pissing contest there to see who's really the boss, which is a scene I loved. That actor, I mentioned Selena earlier this episode, that actor played her brother in the movie Selena. So I, you know, always love when I see him anywhere. And it's so weird to think of, you know, the guy who played, you know, the drums in Selena, or I'm sorry, the bass in Selena. And see him here as like a crime lord, and he's all, you know, short versus Mahershala Ali, who's much taller, and just watching that standoff. And then at the same time, he's coming off as so threatening.
Oh, I know. I was impressed with that scene, because you're right, the height difference. And so the presence he has to have, not only just to stand there, but to stand there and eat candy and drop the wrapper on the floor and drop the half-eaten pieces of the candy on the floor. It's like, that's like F U-M-F-er. Like,
yeah.
Without
actually, there's a couple, I think it's a couple episodes from now where he says a really bad cuss word in Spanish. And I was like, they're saying that in Marvel now?
It's but, Netflix.
Yeah, it's Netflix. But yeah, it's the advantage of being able to be bilingual is you can slip a lot of stuff past the radar.
Yeah, I think it's a little bit of that, and it's a little bit of they want Netflix to be a little bit grittier. And honestly, we don't know the ratings. Netflix does not release how many people have seen the show, and it's hard to count anyway, as we know from podcasting. Is it the same person watching the episode multiple times, or is somebody different, or even from the same household? Like, I've got 5 people that live in my house. Is it the same person watching it 10 times, or is it each individual person watching it 2 times or something like that? It's really hard to account for, and that's probably why they're not actually releasing numbers, because with Nielsen, supposedly they can discern all that. I disagree with it. I think they actually have the same issues as everybody else does in accounting for how many people actually watched it. But, you know, they've done statistical analysis on Nielsen for years and years, so they think they got it in the bag. Fine, whatever. The point being, Netflix has got to be outperforming. The Marvel Netflix series has got to be outperforming anything comic book related on broadcast TV or cable TV right now. And they can be grittier on Netflix. And I think they're saying, this is a win for us. We need to keep this going. Now, Disney, for its part, is like, well, we still need to keep something for the kids on the regular TV. And even though Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is on at 10 o'clock, it's still kind of that entry drug into the Marvel universe if you haven't done it already. So I don't know, whatever. We'll see where it goes. I expect the Netflix series to be more and more gritty.
I disagree with S.H.I.E.L.D. being the entry, because it's at 10 o'clock. They've been pushing that back, and the later in the night, the fewer viewers. So to me, it's almost like, we have this. We don't know what to do with it anymore. Let's shove it in the closet and see if it'll figure itself out.
Well, let's be frank. The Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. analysis is the only reason that Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. makes it to another season is because Disney is saying we need something on network TV. I don't think it makes it to next season. I think the Inhumans might be a gateway drug for people on the actual Marvel side. There's other stuff going on. And we'll see where it goes. But Lauren, I think you'll agree with me. We're not expecting another season of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. at this point in time.
I highly, highly doubt that we will get another season just because of Inhumans.
Right. So, as I said, gateway drug, I did put quotes around it, Michelle. I'm not expecting it to be around, and it is what it is right now for Disney. They're just going to have to figure it out. They just had like $7 billion, Disney Corporation did, with the film industry, with Star Wars coming out this weekend. So they're flying high right now on that money. But I did on Gonna Geek last week talk about how ESPN is starting to even lose money, and ABC/Disney's biggest cash cow overall is their TV entities at $24 billion of revenue every year, eclipsing the film and the theme parks part of their repertoire as well. So they got to make it profitable, and I just don't see Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. as being profitable. Michelle, what do you think? I mean, we haven't asked you. What do you think about Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. making it into a next season versus transitioning to Netflix for the Marvel Universe?
I too see the writing on the wall. First, the cancellation of Agent Carter, the not going forward with Most Wanted, and then the announcement of the Inhumans. The Netflix is doing really well. For those of you who think that, oh, Netflix just renews everything, in fact, they canceled Marco Polo. So they do have their own in-house rating system. You do have to live up to a particular standard, even in Netflix. They don't tell anybody, but they actually do have it. So, you know, I think it's one of those things. We're going to get Inhumans on ABC. Maybe we'll get Daredevil on Netflix or something like that. He seemed to, I don't know if popular But some of the fans actually did like seeing the character. Some of us didn't like the execution of the character, because even I got a little confused as to the phase things. But yeah, I really don't want to see Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. go away, but have to face reality.
Yeah. But in the meantime, we have all these great Netflix shows right now that have been doing well. None of them have bombed so far. You got two seasons of Daredevil, you got a season of Jessica Jones, and you've got this season of Luke Cage, which everybody's saying is great. So, and so far it's been good too. So, as I was saying, lots of great action. You've got Luke Cage rising up. You've got, we haven't talked a lot about this. There was an important conversation, actually multiple important conversations that happened between Cottonmouth and his cousin, the Councilwoman Dillard. And there's going to be a new, there's going to have to be a new reality, because she's caught with her pants down because her office was in that building that Luke Cage raided.
Yep.
Yeah, she's upset because, first off, I love that sequence, a black man in a hoodie, you know, ripping off that car door, going in there, bullets flying, the couch coming out, and him taking the money. He took one bag, but he let the cops know, and there's all that money being seized. And she's mm-hmm. like, I am the face. You know, you do all that type of stuff in the shadow, but when you're icky blackness gets on me, everybody sees it because I'm the one in the public with the nice little image. And she's upset by that.
Yeah. One of the things that I love about this show is it is not shy about its symbology, like Luke with the hoodie. And, you know, even what the first thing I thought of when I saw him ripping off that car door in the ads was Captain America, the first shield that he grabbed as, you know, Big Steve, once he had that transformation, was a car door.
Oh, yeah?
So, yeah, that was what it made me think of. And you just have these, like, these little touchstones, whether it's the movies or whether it's to, you know, current day events or past events or just stuff like that. And it's not apologizing for bringing any of that up at all. And I love it. I read a review that called Luke Cage one of the most unapologetically black shows this year or in the past few years. And I agree. And I love that. There's a bunch of shows right now. There's like Atlanta and Luke Cage and a bunch of other stuff that it's they're black shows, but they're not like kind of filtered so that it's like a white show, but performed by black people. Like you had a lot of those like sitcoms and stuff, like Family Matters and stuff, where it was a black family and every now and then they would have black issues. But for the most part, it was a, you know, a nice, bland, unoffensive family show that could essentially be performed by white people. And it's really good to see yourself represented. I'm not black, but it's really rare to see a good portrayal of Hispanics on TV. So I get why people are really glad to see a good, nuanced, true kind of feeling portrayal of blacks on TV.
I'm just enjoying the increase in writing quality over the last 10, 15, 20 years. Because when I was growing up in the 70s and 80s, that stuff, even the high drama like Dallas or Dynasty or whatever, like whatever, and, you know, when you look back at it, that was just a shocking moment from shocking moment of people conniving each other, and often white shows as well. Now, I'm just glad that the writing is at the point where it doesn't really matter what the authenticity of anybody is. As long as it's a good show, people will come in and watch it. And that's really the point here. This is a good show. And let's go on to another good part of the show is Misty Knight.
Yes.
Had another great vision of trying to dissect the crime scenes with Luke Cage. Came out that she and Luke Cage had a night together when she was casing the nightclub, and really tainting her involvement in this entire investigation. I'm not sure what the ethics of a police force would be. I know, like with the FBI, that would be considered a no. Yeah, you don't really want to do that. But her character,
you are not supposed to do that as a police officer. Actually, earlier, I think it was last year, there was a big deal in Hawaii because it was ruled that cops could no longer sleep with prostitutes as part of stings, like prostitution stings. And everyone was like, why was this legal in the first place? You're not supposed to. Like, this is a clear abuse of power. And that is what it is. It's an abuse of your involvement in, like, if you are sexually involved in a case, it's a conflict of interest.
I can definitely see that.
I would have to talk to some of my friends and relatives in law enforcement to get more of the details. But I can assure you it is a conflict of interest and you should be taken off that case.
At the very least, it's entrapment. Here, come sleep with me. I'll give you some money. And you do that and you hand the money over and say, okay, well, I'm going to arrest you now. Really? That's just not cool at all. I don't believe in human trafficking myself, but I know it's legal in parts of the country, but not like that.
Human trafficking is not legal. Sex work, that's another thing altogether.
Fair enough. You can't always equate the two, but most of the time they're equated.
Yeah, a lot of the time, especially like right now, I live in Houston. We are one of the largest cities for human trafficking, and it's a big problem.
Yeah.
Like people will bring in immigrants from other countries, right now, particularly Asia and Mexico, Central America. And you will find these massage parlors that have pretty much enslaved women in there. So it's a very bad thing.
It is. To go more on to Misty, though, it's amazing with all her insights, she is blind to her partner because she's able to dissect crime scenes. She's able to have this incredible local insight because of growing up in the neighborhood, but her partner and she, in this episode, you really see her and her partner working well together. You know, they do the shoot for it, whatever that is, rock, paper, scissors to figure out who's going to drive and stuff. And they're just right on it. They're in sync with each other. She doesn't have a clue as to what her partner is really doing.
Yeah. It's kind of like that. It's not so much blinded by love, but it's like blinded by pure trust. You're supposed to have each other's back when you're police partners. It's like it's an assumption. I'm a cop. You're a cop. We both believe in the same thing. Okay, sure. You might think a vigilante kind of helps you with your job, so you only have to do paperwork. But that's just a minor little quibble. We're still on the same side, but. Nope.
Yeah, it's kind of like, you know, anytime somebody, you know, there's like a serial killer or something and they talk to the neighbors or the family and they're like, well, I didn't see anything unusual. People who are really like good at lying and keeping a double life, the reason that they are able to do so long is they are able to exploit the people that are close to them. And Scarf right now is very much exploiting that trust from Misty. He knows that she gets distracted by the casework, so she has these big blind spots that he's able to take advantage of. She trusts him, so he's able to take advantage of that and go and work out a deal because he thinks he's safe because he's in that blind spot.
At first, I was like, maybe he killed Chico to shield Luke Cage. Like, he knew who Luke Cage was, and he just had that big long conversation with Misty about supporting the vigilanteism because he didn't have to do any paperwork or anything like that. So I thought, well, maybe that's what he's still wrong, by the way, but so maybe that's what he's doing. Nope, he's full-fledged traitor, full-fledged dirty cop on the payroll of Cottonmouth, and we see that killing Chico, poor Chico. Again, Chico's not innocent in everything either, but he did think he was doing the right thing, and he ends up getting killed for it, just like his compadres in the heist itself from episode one. So the only thing left I have in the notes, and we'll finish those off first, is the music by Charles Bradley. Again, another great episode with the music involvement in the Luke Cage episode.
Yes, I like we've mentioned before, this show, I'm not going to say it lives on its music, because there's some great performances, there's some great cinematography, the action, just the writing, everything. But the music definitely helps to bring life into it. And Charles Bradley, I mean, he's great. And you look at the list of stuff that he's been in and done, and it's just like, how did they get, you know, such a good group of people? I'm amazed.
Yeah, this has been great. I've been reading articles about the musicians throughout the series, because it's basically kind of spoiler free to read about them. It's just the entire series front to back is just packed full of great stuff, and it's great to have a R&B club or hip-hop club or whatever you want to call it, to have these people be able to perform at least for now. I don't know if the club's gonna last much longer, but it's a center point where they can be, and it's great to bring them forward. So I think is just amazing. I've enjoyed it. Not a hip hop fan myself, but these songs I've been able to enjoy, especially in the context of these episodes. Michelle, we've been talking about it for two episodes, how great this music is, these songs are. How are you liking it in conjunction with the series?
Oh, it just adds this other layer. I mean, that's one of the things about this show. It's, you know, it's proud to be Black. It's one of the few shows that it has to take place in Harlem. If you take Luke Cage out of Harlem, it becomes a completely different story. It, you know, Luke Cage is of Harlem. It's part of the fabric of the show, and the music just, you know, amplifies it, and but does it in such a nice, subtle way. It's not like all of a sudden this, you know, huge soaring sort of notice the soundtrack here and everything, but just like using, you know, the just subtly in the background, Enemies All Around Me by Ghostface Killah. That's in the Domingo scene. And then just the great use of Bring the Ruckus during Luke Cage going in. It's Wu-Tang Clan, of course. It's just so many good little points about this show. It's just, wow.
Mm-hmm. And as a little research aside note, I was curious because everybody seemed to know Pop. And I was like, okay, there are local celebrities in each town that everybody seems to know or know of or that sort of thing. So I was like, okay, so Harlem's how big? How many people are in Harlem that would know this guy? 335,000 as of a 2000 census. That's the latest information I had. And in conjunction with the rest of New York City, the entire population of New York City, according to the 2015 census, is right around 8.5 million, with 2.5 million in Brooklyn, 1.6 million in Manhattan, and 2.3 million in Queens. So that gives you a rough estimate of where the population of Harlem kind of fits in the New York City. And of course, there's the metropolitan area as well outside of New York City that you have to consider. But just in New York City, about 8.5 million people, 335,000-ish, which is probably more than that because I'm guessing it grew since 2000, is what the people that know Pop. So that's kind of your middle city of what's going on around the Harlem area and what all of this is being affected. All right, that's it for my notes. Lauren, do you have anything left on the episode that we haven't discussed yet?
Nothing I can think of off the top of my head.
Okay, Michelle, I know you got like 10 things right off the top of your head.
I love this. I actually watched this. I couldn't stop watching it. Unlike Daredevil season 2, I could stop watching that. So this one I actually did I tried not to binge it, but it ended up being over 3 days anyway. I just found it. It's one of my favorites. It's up there with me, like Jessica Jones, and everything. So I'm one of the people that like Jessica Jones and Luke Cage a little bit more than Daredevil. So I'm going to get flack for that, but I don't care.
They're so different that you can like one better than another one. I even think that the second season of Daredevil kind of took it down a notch or two from what it really originated at. Now, who knows what it's going to end up at in the end, because we still have to go through the Defenders in the next seasons of all these shows. But you're right. You could like one more than another one and not be wrong.
Yeah, because it does have a different pace than the other ones. I know a lot of people were like, oh, it's not actiony like Daredevil. It's not. It's got, like I said, it's of Harlem. And if you know Harlem history, then you know about like the jazz and the Harlem Renaissance. So it has that flavor, that ebb and flow of pace. So it does kind of get like a little languidy, and then it kind of bop, bop, it bops because of just, that's just the rhythm of Harlem. And it's just something that I really appreciate about this show.
All right. Well, it's been fun watching it so far. I have only watched the first three episodes. I'm savoring them at this point in time because I know we're going to podcast on them. And it is going to be fun to get to the end. Hang with us, folks. We're going to get you more Luke Cage in the coming weeks. Ladies, are you ready to talk about some news?
Yep.
All right. Yep. Here we go. All right, it is the week before the holidays here in the United States. The holidays being like the Christmas, Hanukkah, New Year's time of the year. And so news has kind of ground slower a little bit as people in the industry start taking their vacation. But we still have some good news stories. We're going to start it off with some Punisher cast.
Yes, flickeringmyth.com has the first cast picture, the full cast picture of the Punisher series. And they have the cast members and their characters' names. Hmm. So we have Deborah Ann Woll returning as Karen Page. Mm-hmm. Ben Barnes is going to be in it, which kind of is surprising, but cool. Right now you can see him in Westworld. Which, yeah, I just started watching. Jamie Newman, who I believe is, I'm trying to remember if that's Jamie King and if she's going by her married name now. No, different one.
Okay.
But yeah, a bunch of people that I haven't necessarily heard of, but it has me very interested. Yeah, and they're all just dressed as people and not costumes, but still.
It's a good looking cast. And the Jon Bernthal, I'm trying to figure out, is that a hood or is that dreadlocks?
Because I think it's a hoodie. Because I know he does, I've seen some pictures of him where he has kind of the, you know, homeless look going on with the beard and the scruffy hair. But no, it looks like he's just wearing like a hoodie and.
Oh, okay.
It's just that he has dark hair, so it's blending into it.
Yeah, he's black hair with a black hoodie. That's probably it.
You know, it does look like they could be straight off the boat off of Caribbean, you know, like in a Caribbean cruise. You know, he could.
Oh my God, why don't we have a show about that? Like superheroes go on vacation.
Oh, they do little.
Yeah, they used to do comic issues about that back in the day. Why can't we get one of those now? Like a digital short. Why don't we do that?
Yeah, so you go on vacation to the Caribbean, you take a cruise ship down to Jamaica, you go and try to get the dreadlocks done on the shore.
Instead of norovirus on the cruise, I mean, half the people on it come down with some sort of supervillain disease. Marvel, I wrote it for you.
I think that just happened with the Mockingbird comics, actually.
I think so. Yeah. Maybe I'm not as original as I thought.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, it's like the poop ship, only it's aliens.
There you go. Okay, moving
on. I forgot about the poop ship, but I didn't.
Yeah. Great. So moving on from the poop ship to Doctor Strange, which is not a poop ship. It's an issue that we've been covering off and on, and it's a very important issue. We're not going to whitewash it. No pun intended, really. Seriously, no pun intended. Yeah, but we're going to talk about it. So what do we got here, Lauren?
Okay, so Jezebel has posted a couple articles about this. Tilda Swinton sent Jezebel her email exchange with Margaret Cho, a comedian who I love, about Doctor Strange diversity and whitewashing. Margaret Cho is Korean. And the email, I read it. They seem to all be very polite in tone. But that's one of the sort of questions is, people are told, you know, don't be confrontational when talking about racism. And women especially are told, don't be impolite ever. And Margaret Cho later on in a podcast that she was on with Bobby Lee, who's another Korean comedian, they were discussing whitewashing, such as the movie 21, because the real life incident where that took place, everyone was Asian and they took advantage of racism to cover up the fact that they were card counting. And in the movie, it was played by a bunch of white people. And Margaret Cho talked about the Tilda Swinton thing. And, you know, being Margaret Cho, she said that she was, you know, joking about it. But then she said that the ensuing conversation was kind of a fight about why the part should not have gone to her. Which, yes, Tilda Swinton's emails were pretty defensive. And at the end, she says, well, I'm producing a movie with Steve Yeun, who plays Glenn on Walking Dead. And who was also Korean. And she said, oh, it's Bobby Lee interpreted as, oh, like I have a black friend, so I can do this. Okay, race is a tricky issue. We have talked about this before. Hollywood is not the best when it comes to race. We have also talked about this before. The way that you get people into doors is by giving them chances. We have also talked about this before. Remember that it is not about you specifically when you have a discussion about race and stuff. It is about a system. That is really all I can say about the issue.
Yeah. Michelle, do you have any thoughts about this issue that we haven't had a chance to talk about yet?
It is very tricky. I'm not saying that she's right, but I think it's interesting that Tilda Swinton actually wanted to address it and figure out what is going on. It's taking her some time to, I think, realize it, but at least she's trying to have that conversation, which a lot of people don't want to have. And I think it's one of those things that she's just, you know, she's trying, you know, like, this is how I see it. And everything. And I, there is that part where, you know, she doesn't know about the system and the systematic racism. And I think she's just finally being exposed to it. And it's like she's kind of, I don't know, baby stepping into it, but at least she's, I know, I hate being the whole, at least she tried, but yeah. It is one of those things that a lot of people, wouldn't have tried to talk about. And I think she is trying to talk about it.
Something that's also, I feel like, okay, Tilda Swinton is from Scotland and European racism is not the same as American racism. There's different historical backgrounds. It's still there. I mean, nobody pretend it's not there because it is. But Hollywood is mostly an American thing. I mean, there's still, you know, production companies and stuff in Europe. There's a lot more movie production companies opening up in other countries, you know, Bollywood, Nollywood. But a lot of the systemic racism and stuff that you see in Hollywood right now is very deeply American racism.
Yeah.
And a lot of the reluctance to change it is the American system refusing to change. Like right now you have the BAFTAs saying that as a step forward in 2019, in order to encourage people starting now, they're not going to even consider movies that don't fit certain qualifications for diverse cast and crew, which I think is great. Because again, the only way that you get people in is to give people a chance. And I think that opening up doors leads you to realizing how great new blood is.
And the whole thing.
We get, you know, people always complain about, oh my God, another Adam Sandler movie, another Tom Cruise movie, another. Well, why don't we have a variety of things? Like right now, we have 1.5 billion TV stations. We have Netflix. We are spoiled for choice. And a lot of it is good. So why don't we spoil ourselves for choice with actors and writers and directors?
Yeah, there's this great hashtag or meme where it's why not John Cho? And they put him like on like as a star of The Martian. And it's like, you know, and other things. And it's like, yeah, you know, why not somebody else? You know, like Tom Cruise, you're great and everything, but you don't need to be in everything. Ryan Gosling, you don't need to be in everything. You guys aren't broke. You can sit one out and let somebody just as talented, maybe even a little bit more, get that role and do that. So, cause I would have watched The Martian with John Cho in it. And that's just it. Everybody's like, oh my goodness, this made money. Of course, you know, of course people are going to go to Luke Cage, you know,
people like seeing themselves represented. It's not science. It's
and just, people like seeing other things. I loved seeing Luke Cage cause it's like, wow, this is mind-blowingly entertainment. And just the way that they see everything and the way that they constructed the show, I'm like going, wow.
Yeah, this is new and exciting.
Yeah.
And one of the reasons I like science fiction, sci-fi, is because you can imagine societies that have already made that transition that this is no longer an issue with. So it is great to see as you go forward. And even with like the Honorverse, which is David Weber's science fiction universe, Honor Harrington herself runs into a old way of doing things when she goes to her second planet home, basically. And it's interesting to see how rapidly they're able to be brought into kind of a newer age of things, not without significant issues, but not to spoil anything, but it is a fascinating read for that example as well. In the meantime, I want to
and
see.
And isn't more. Honor Harrington mostly like of Asian heritage in the books?
Yeah, her parents are. Wow, it'll have to be a discussion for another time because I know way too much about it. But her parents are definitely have. Abnormal heritage, even for the planets that they're on. So,
yeah. And you know that if they were to make a movie of it, she would be played by like Angelina Jolie.
I know, which would be the total wrong body style for Honor Harrington, too, because of a whole bunch of it's science fiction. It's in the future. You're not only dealing with different planets growing up, but you're also dealing with genetic. Tampering is a bad word, but you have life extended series.
Yeah, genetic engineering.
Yeah, going on as well. So all of that. In the meantime, I want to see more of this stuff go on where you do have different people of different races as leads and genders as well as we go forward. And talking about a variety of different people and genders, we have at least a currently complete compiled list for characters in the Infinity Wars.
Yes, the Mary Sue's article is titled Infinity War will introduce us to Brie Larson's Captain Marvel, plus more familiar faces. So yay, Captain Marvel. But also, here's the list for the rest of the people they're planning to use in Infinity War. Thor, Thanos, Star-Lord, Bucky, Black Widow, Stephen Strange, Captain Marvel, Gamora, Nebula, Hawkeye, Captain America, Steve Rogers, Scarlet Witch, Rocket Raccoon, Groot, Nick Fury, Ant-Man, Wong, Drax, Vision, Black Panther, the Hulk, and Iron Man.
And you missed a few in there too, like for example Elizabeth Olsen as one of Maxima.
Well, but I did say Scarlet Witch.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah,
but yeah, it's just incredible. And oh, by the way, today I went to the comic book store, and this is the new Captain Marvel title that Marvel is going. This is episode or an issue number 0. It's the Mighty Captain Marvel. You can get it at your local comic book store. I suggest you do. I actually haven't had a chance to read it, but I saw this on the list to discuss, and I'm like, gotta bring this up. And that is just a tremendous list. We've heard of big lists before of people being considered, but this is confirmed in the movie. I'm wondering if they're going to do like a X-Men thing where they film a lot of stuff, but yet some actors actually get cut out of it just due to time. I hope they don't end up doing that.
You know, they're probably going to have to.
Yeah.
It looks like they're going to do the space mystic part of this first, because I know this is supposed to be kind of a two-parter-ish. So I wonder if this is like the start of Thanos, because Thanos would start in space and eventually probably go to Earth. That's what I, because with the Guardians being involved and the mystical part, I'm wondering if that's how they're going to do it. He starts in space and then, oh my goodness, he's at Earth. And then here's all the Earth heroes, Spider-Man and all that. Cause you know, Spider-Man's going to be in the next one at least.
Mm-hmm. So in the comics recently, so the MCU hasn't really discovered Thanos yet, but in the comics recently, Thanos has shown up in the Ultimates and in Civil War, because he basically was part of the start of Civil War as the first time all the superheroes just got together in one mass to defeat Thanos. Spoilers, I'm sorry, but it does happen, and it will be interesting seeing him on the big screen as a main character in a movie. We've seen him before, but we haven't seen him as a main character, so we'll see what happens. I like the space stuff. You know, that's me. I just talked about Honor Harrington in science fiction, so I'm all about the space for a variety of reasons. Okay, moving on into another space-based thing. Moving on back into the Earth, when talking about X-Men and mutants, there has been a back and forth on adding Wolverine into a possible Deadpool sequel. Well, we've got Hugh Jackman's response.
Yeah, well, it's sort of a response. It's not directly addressing it, but on his Instagram, Hugh Jackman recorded a video of himself, excuse me, Ryan Reynolds, talking in an Australian accent about getting a star on the Hall of Fame, on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. And it's really funny. I really like watching these two rib on each other.
Yeah, so go check it out. It's at the Mary Sue.
Funnily enough, we brought Deadpool down to my in-laws this week because they hadn't seen it. And I wasn't expecting them to like it as much as they did. And also watching Deadpool with your in-laws is kind of a weird experience. But yeah.
Ryan Reynolds is up for a global
Golden Globe.
Golden Globe.
Yeah. And so is the movie.
Did you see his acceptance speech? I think it was pretty recently for something or other, where he just basically thanked Tom Hanks. I just talked about Tom Hanks because he's like, I didn't prepare a speech, so.
It's a wise choice. If you're going to pick a stalwart of the Hollywood industry, Tom Hanks is not a bad place to go.
I guess his kid is obsessed with Tom Hanks. I don't know.
You take a look at even married couples in Hollywood, and Tom Hanks is one of the few with Rita White that have maintained their marriage over decades of a lot of stuff happening. And it's not like he has had a Mel Gibson or a Tom Cruise moment. So for now, Tom Hanks is the king. All right. Talking about good moments, though, we're coming up on the holidays, as I mentioned before. And we have a bunch of, you know, fire holiday stuff, you know, that get streamed on TV on like the Hallmark Channel. And apparently, Marvel got into it this year by giving us some Fireside 4K holiday videos.
Yes, on their YouTube channel. The article's on Yahoo. On their YouTube channel, they have 10-hour-long Fireside videos for people's houses. There's Thor's Asgard home, and then there's the close-up. There's the Guardians of the Galaxy's place with a little baby Groot. There's Captain America's Brooklyn apartment. There's Miss Marvel's place. There's Iron Man's place. It's fun. It's really cute. I watched a little bit of them. Nothing much really happens. It's just kind of a thing to have on for ambiance. Last year for Christmas, we put on the Vader roasting as an open fire for like an hour or so. So those videos can be kind of fun. There's also, I mean, it's not Marvel, but there's like the Grumpy Cat or just cats playing for an hour. Little Bub is one of my favorite ones. It's a cat just purring in front of a fire for an hour.
So I scrolled through really fast the Up Close with Guardians Fireside video, because there's a little baby Groot just to the left of the orb that's glowing in the fireplace or whatever. And I thought, for sure, baby Groot is going to move at some point in this video. And maybe he does, but I didn't see it with the quick scan through. So if you see baby Groot move in this Up Close with Guardians Fireside video, please let me know. I want to see the baby Groot move. All right, that about wraps it up for the news for the week. Let's get on to some feedback. This past week, we got a few hitbacks from listeners of the show. Thank you very much. We appreciate the interaction. So, at Born to Eat Bacon tweeted us on the 19th of December. He said, "The Doctor Strange crate I won from Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. arrived. My son's getting a Strange Pop for Christmas. Thanks, Stargate Pioneer." Well, it's not Stargate Pioneer. It's the entire Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. crew, and it's the anonymous donor. So, thank you to everybody, not just Stargate Pioneer, but I'm glad you got it. And that's why we cut off the actual contest when we did on the 14th of December, because I wanted to make sure that it would get to the winner in time for Christmas. So that's great. You know, Lauren, you live tweet, you know, whatever mm-hmm. you watch during the week. And in this particular case, you were live tweeting Luke Cage, and you had a tweet that mentioned something, didn't you?
Yes, I did. When I was watching the episode, if I remember correctly, it was in the morgue when Cottonmouth and Luke Cage are talking, and Cottonmouth starts laughing. And I said, "I can't decide if Cottonmouth's more threatening when he's angry or when he's smiling." And at Born to Eat Bacon replied, "Smiling. The answer is smiling." And I think I have to agree with him. Because when he's smiling, I mean, it's... When he's angry, I mean, you know he's angry. When he's smiling, he could be angry, and you know he's planning something.
And he's smiling when he fires that missile.
Yeah.
So.
Coming down your chimney. Yeah, he definitely. Cottonmouth smile. I don't care. Cottonmouth is just scary. Any of those guys are. Dominguez is scary. They're all scary. That's what makes it a great series. Mm-hmm. They're all scary. Michelle, we also got hit up by Stallworth and constant listener and fan of the show at Mr. Pericles. What did he have to say?
Said, "So, Method Man writing about Ghost Rider and Krampus. That's a sentence I never thought I'd write. LOL."
This is amazing. So, Method Man, who's a huge Marvel fan, he's... I don't want to spoil it, but he does have a cameo in Luke Cage. He is mentioned in, he has a song in Iron Man 1, and he's mentioned, you know, Iron Man in a bunch of his songs. And he's just written his first Marvel comic. And it's out this week as a digital comic. It's Ghost Rider Christmas Special, well, Xmas Special, Infinite Comic #1. It has Robbie Reyes. and he's fighting the Krampus, and it's great. I love Method Man. I love Robbie Reyes. I love the Krampus. So just, yes, this is great.
Can't wait to see it in Luke Cage. Because thank you for not spoiling it, by the way, for me. But yeah, that's it for the feedback for this week. We will be pretty much off a week from the feedback, but we will be getting feedback back to you in 2 weeks. So stay tuned for that. Ladies, it's time to walk this one out. As I was saying before, in 2 weeks, we will be discussing Luke Cage Episode 4, Step Into the Arena, on Wednesday, January 4th, 2017. In the meantime, we might possibly have a special episode for you where Haley will give her take on Slingshot with whatever guest she wants. So stay tuned for that. It might happen, might not. It just depends on her travels. And of course, winter delays and plane delays and stuff like that. So can't promise anything. It will not be streamed live, but it might be coming out on the feed. So watch for it in between now and the next Luke Cage episode. So in the meantime, on January 4th, you can find our live stream at www.geeks.live, as you can every Wednesday night, except for next week, at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific.
You can also find us on our website at legendsofshield.com.
You can always call us at our phone number, 844-THE-BUS-1. That's 844-843-2871.
You can catch us on our Facebook page, Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. Podcast.
You can also find us at Twitter, at Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D.
You can see our Tumblr at legendsofshield.tumblr.com.
And don't forget our YouTube channel. That's youtube.com/gunnageek. So that's it for this week. Michelle, thank you very much for stepping in for the wayward agent Haley as she is off on assignment. We really appreciate you stepping in and filling that seat.
Oh, thank you. I'm glad I got a chance to finally talk about Luke Cage with someone. So this is exciting.
It is. It definitely is. And I want to thank our listeners for tuning in. We really appreciate this. This will most likely be the last time I talk to you from Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. in 2016. It has been a phenomenal year. You guys rock. It's been our best year ever in terms of downloads. We don't really talk about that too much, but thank you very much for listening in. We really appreciate you, and keep those downloads coming in. Really, if you guys have any thoughts or whatever, go ahead and hit us up on any of those contact methods, because we're not doing this for money, obviously. We're doing this for fun, and we're doing this to talk about Marvel stuff, because we all like Marvel stuff, as witnessed by if you're watching on YouTube, my geeky jerseys, my Iron Man geeky jerseys, or whatever they call it. It's not Iron Man, they call it something. But yeah, we're all Marvel fans, and whether it's the MCU, Netflix, whatever, we like it. And thank you very much for liking it with us and staying with us. And we want to hear from you about exactly what you like or your thoughts about the general matter. So thank you very much.
And thank you to everybody who has followed us on Twitter, who talks to us on Twitter, who sends us news, who joins during the live tweets, just whatever, on any comments. It has been a fun year this year, doing live tweets and hearing from you, talking with all of you online. And it's just been, I mean, for all the ups and downs this year has had, and there have been a lot, something that I've always looked forward to is doing the live tweets and communicating with you all, and then coming here on Wednesday nights and talking with, you know, SP and Haley and whatever guests that we might have. Michelle, it's been wonderful having you on whenever you come on. And I really can't say how much I appreciate having this to look forward to every week.
And before we leave, I just want to say, since Haley's not here, remember our contest for the Coulson fan art. We really have been looking forward to giving this away for quite some time. I left it for the end of the year for those people that really want it over the holidays. So go ahead and hit us up on your favorite Coulson moment in the Marvel universe. So with that, I think it's time to walk it on out. Until next time, I'm Director Stargate Pioneer.
I'm Agent Lauren.
And I'm
Bye. See you guys in 2 weeks.
Bye.
Bye. Sweet Christmas.
Thank you for listening. If you want to leave us feedback, go to gunnageek.com and you will find all our contact information and other shows. You can also visit legendsofshield.com, where you'll find our complete archive of podcasts. The music heard on this podcast is by Kevin McLeod, found at incompetech.com, and also artists on pond5.com and audiojungle.net. The opinions heard on this podcast are those of the individual hosts and do not represent Stargate Pioneer Productions, Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D., or Gunna Geek. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is the property of the Disney Corporation, Marvel Studios, and ABC. No infringement is intended. Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. is copyright 2016.